Okay, are we live?
I guess we are.
Hello, everyone. Hold on one second. Let me just click this nonsense because I'm not great. But I want to welcome everyone to the exclusive. I'm super excited. We're doing a live recap of the Traitors. And I'm even more excited to introduce my good friend and Big Brother 24 winner. And do we say Reindeer's runner-up now? Is that what we're saying?
We can. I don't know. It's a long resume at this point. But, like, if you want to do it, I'm not going to. Oh, my God. Stop. No. Whatever.
Okay. Well, welcome, Taylor Hale. Thank you for joining me.
Happy to be here, Sharon. I've got some thoughts and opinions that might get me banned from ever going on Traitors. But screw it. We're here. Let's elevate the game.
Yes. Okay. Does anyone else hear clicking or is that just me?
Oh, it's got to be my earrings hitting the headphones. Is that what it is?
Oh, I don't know.
We'll take it. It's fine because I got some fighting words, so I'll take off the earrings so I can get the fight.
Is that really what it is?
Probably. Is it done now? Is it gone?
Oh, yeah. Wow.
Yeah.
Okay. There you go.
Okay. At least we fixed it now.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I'm so excited to talk about this. You know, you've been tweeting, but I really want your, like, thoughts on the whole season. Let's not bury the lead here. So CT and Trishel win the game. What were your first thoughts on them as winners?
So first of all, I want to get to saying this because I saw a lot of people say Traitors is out. I'm going to go watch the end and then watch the whole episode. First of all, to all of you, I want to say you have terrible taste and you have questionable decisions and life choices, and I just want you to ruminate on that for a minute. But when it comes to CT and Trishel winning the game, okay, that's fine. That's cute. Good for both of them. I'm always going to root for some gamers to win the game. Like, these are seasoned reality show professionals. They know how to maneuver and manipulate a game. I will root for them. I'm always pro get the least amount of people to the end and take the most amount of money as you can. So I also root for them in that aspect. What I don't like is Trishel's little last-minute confusion that ended up screwing over MJ in the end. Like, MJ is so clearly a faithful, and now your last-minute hesitancy just screwed her in her game. Now, did she play the perfect game? Did she play an excellent game? Did she play a good game? She was there, but she was also in the end. And I don't think that, unless it was an intentional decision to exclude MJ from the winning, I think she should have been there to split the prize. It was, I don't like how it lacked intentionality. That's my only gripe about the ending.
Yeah, so I don't know. Like, Trishel obviously was like, oh, all of a sudden I might think it's CT. Do we believe that? Do we think this was a ploy all along? Like, what? Because I know MJ doesn't believe it.
I wish it was a ploy all along because then I could actually give, oh God, I'm going to get hate for this. Whatever, screw it. I'm in my villain era. I'm in my traitors era, whatever. I wish that I could see actual intentionality. Like, I wish that I saw repeated over and over Trishel and CT saying, we are going there to the end, playing this game together. They said it, but the actions showed otherwise. And I understand why Trishel was like, I don't know. We kept saying we'd go there to the end together, but your actions at roundtable showed me otherwise. Like, you showed me other decisions that make me feel like we're not in this anymore. I get the hesitancy. I just wish that there was a real, this is our final two. We're going to screw over people till we get to the end together. Like, if that's the game, if that's your decision, make decisions that align with that. But that's not what was happening in front of us. So I'm, you know, whatever. Y'all got your check and I'm always going to root for someone to get their check. But come on.
Yeah, it's so hard because I couldn't tell if that was for dramatic effect or she really was like, wait, why is CT? I really couldn't tell. I did not understand.
I think it aligns with how Trishel was playing the game, though. I mean, she would follow her instinct, whether it was wrong or right. But that's when you're faithful, what do? That's what you have to do. So if her instinct at the last minute is saying, I just can't let go of this change in decisions, there was no Machiavellian plan to throw a red herring out there and make it seem like we just need to have a convoluted way to get MJ out the game. No, Trishel was just following her gut instinct. And then she was like, oh, never mind. I guess I'm wrong. Let's go to the end together. And it just screwed MJ. And again, I am not MJ's like biggest game advocate by any means possible. But if I were to see MJ get screwed over in the end, I want to see them screw her over intentionally. And that's not what happened.
Okay, that's fair. So it would have been more fun if it was like,
We planned this.
I feel like CT was sort of saying that, but Trishelle was like, yeah. I don't know.
Yeah.
MJ was clearly still salty at the reunion. I know people are saying, oh, she should get over it. But, like, you know, she has a reason to be salty. What do you think about that?
Yeah, I think I'm not going to be mad at people who are like, I got screwed in the end and I'm not happy about it. You're allowed to not be happy about it. Like, you are allowed to be displeased with how things fall when they don't fall in your favor. What I don't like is when people say, I don't like how this turned out for me, and therefore you are a bad person.
Right. Morality comes into play.
And look, Taylor Mackenzie Dickens Hale, winner of Big Brother 24, who arguably had to like argue her way to the end through morality the entire time, right? However, I'm fully aware of the contracts that we sign. I'm fully aware of the games that we all decide to sign up for. So MJ, when you sign a contract, the same contract that everybody signs that is called the Traitors, be upset that you didn't win the game, but don't look at someone and say, and you are permanently now and forever a traitor because you're a horrible human being and how could you do this and you have terrible morals. Bad morals in a game called the Traitors? I just need everybody to be serious. Like, please be serious. If your favorite, root for your favorite, whether they're a traitor or a faithful, whatever. But don't get all up in arms talking about morality in a game show where it's literally where Alan Cummings is out here talking about lying, deception, deceit. And we want to play morality? Please, save it. I don't have it.
Oh my God, I love it. You're coming in hot. I'm into it.
I just, like, the game's not called the Faithfuls or the Besties or the morality or the trust we have within each other. No, it's called the Traitors. I want to see betrayal and I want to see you smile while you do it. And when you get betrayed, I want to see you smile too because you signed the same contract, dummy. Anyway.
And you're right. In the title, it says Traitors, that implies treason.
Someone's getting betrayed. Treason, betrayal, deceit, lies, deception. You know what it doesn't say? Bugs. And that's why I probably will not go far on the show if I ever get there. But that's not the conversation.
What, you'll lose like $1,000. You'll be fine. Or $200 or whatever nonsense they were doing.
That's right.
Okay, well, speaking of saltiness then, can we talk about, because Phaedra's really upset with Dan. What do we think about this?
Listen, I am a Phaedra theatrics fan. I can never fully forgive her after how she did Candy on the Housewives. Like, that's on me, okay? But I love the theatrics of Phaedra. I love the energy. I am team good TV. But what you do after the cameras drop is you drop the game. And I get it. This is Phaedra's first time doing competition reality, but she's a reality TV vet. Like, there should be some understanding that people play the games they have to play. And I'm sorry. Look, y'all can hate me for saying I'm 100% behind Dan doing what he had to do. If you are in that position, Phaedra, baby girl, I'm not your best friend when the whole round table is looking at me and saying, well, you know, Taylor's obviously a traitor, so we got to get her out. You know what I'm doing? I'm throwing another traitor under the bus because that's the only way that you can survive. I'll do it a lot better than Dan did it. I'm sorry, Dan, but you have to spend your entire days in that game showing reasons why you think other people are traitors. Like, you can't just wait until you get to the round table and say, and here's my 25 million page essay on why someone else is a traitor. What? No, you have to consistently prove to everybody around you that you are hunting out other traitors. Hi, again, once again, quiet girl, love being alone. Love not talking to people, but if I'm playing a game called the Traitors and people are looking at me saying, Taylor's not hunting out traitors. You know what I'm turning into? A truffle snuffing pig, baby. I'm hunting them bitches down. Like, what? The nose will be sniffing for traitors, even though I am one. And when my back is against the wall, I'm throwing the traitor who is least known to be a traitor under the bus. Why? Because it throws everyone's ideas off on what it means to be a traitor. I think if you walk into these games, the easiest thing is to say, okay, there's probably going to be a Bravo girly, someone from Survivor, and someone from Big Brother as a traitor. That's just what I would assume at this point.
Yeah.
The hardest ones to, Yeah, and the hardest ones to snuff out are going to be the Bravo people. If you could give me CBS reality people, okay, I can figure out who's a traitor out of the small group. With the Bravo crew, you've got Below Deck. You've got, I mean, I'm sure Vanderpump Rules will get in there soon. You've got all the housewives. You've got shows that don't even exist anymore. Shaw of the Sunset is kaput.
Canceled.
And we've had two people in a row from Shaw's. So, like, it's harder to snuff out who the Bravo person's going to be. If I, a CBS reality vet, am one of the 3 million different traders that could be in there, I'm throwing the least likely trader under the bus so that everybody at that round table is thinking, oh my God, wait, could the politician from England also be a traitor? Could it be somebody else? Maybe it's not just the same competition reality people that we think are always going to be traitors. That buys me time and potentially my other CBS reality ally or competition reality ally some time, throws things off, creates chaos, and it builds more of a case to argue against other people for, hi, me a traitor, to murder people at night and get away with it. So be mad that Phaedra, your favorite, got thrown under the bus. I get it. I want to root for my favorite too. But I'm not going to sit here and point at Dan and be like, you dirty dog, you nasty boy, you terrible person. No, he played with the card, the hand of cards that were in front of him.
Yeah. I think multiple things can be true, right?
Like, yes.
Doesn't have to be one or the other. Dan, and the other thing is Dan's not doubling down. He's admitting like, hey, I messed up. I didn't play this right. So like,
yes.
I'm kind of like, guys, can we lay off the man? But yeah, it was,
it's not that deep.
No, it's not. And it sucked seeing Phaedra so upset. Cause like, I love Phaedra and I think she thinks Dan's worse as a person than he is. Cause he's playing a game. I don't know.
So yeah. Again, it's so bizarre to me. Like, people are not bad people because they play literally the game. Like, there's a rule book probably, and they're literally just playing the game, like Monopoly, reading the instructions and playing that. If they did some crazy behind the scenes stuff to manipulate and pull strings and other stuff, or if they're like, I don't know, racist, okay, you can it's different. It's different.
Do you think Dan, like, what was Dan's move? Should he have planted those Phaedra seeds earlier, or was it just a Hail Mary? That was kind of his only move at that point.
Yes, dummy. Yes, dummy. Oh my God. Dan. I know you said to retire, but like, let's make it like a Law Roach type of retirement. Cause I want to play this game with you so I can beat you. Cause you showed me how easy it is, baby.
Michigan showdown. I'm into it.
Honestly, reindeer games with only Michigan people. Really, we just needed to add Dan last time, but it's okay. Yeah, look, my point in all of this, if I am a traitor going on this show, y'all, I'm never going on the show because I'm giving away all my secrets. We got to delete this after like 48 hours or something.
Well, if you go, the game is evolving, so maybe it'll be different by the time you play.
We'll see, potentially, which I do appreciate. But if, okay, there's three traitors, why am I fighting for the traitors if I know that they'll be replaced continuously as the game goes along? So why am I playing your game? I'm going to pretend like I'm playing your game, but I'm not actually going to play your game. I'm going to be planting seeds of deception from the moment I know who the other traitor is. I will figure out your weaknesses. I will figure out your strengths. I'll figure out exactly who you're aligned with. And I will become best friends with those people and say, but you know, why is she so cozy to you? And why is she getting rid of all your best friends? Why is he so quiet over there? Or why is he talking way too much over there? Bananas. Like, you throw traitors under the bus. If you're a traitor, you throw traitors under the bus. I'm not going to the end with the traitors. I'm going to the end with faithfuls that all think that I'm so close and so loyal and faithful. And the second we all throw that green coal or whatever into the fire, guess who gets the whole pot? Me. And I'm taking all the men. I'm taking all the men to the end with me too, because they'll do all the heavy lifting of like, they put CT to work, baby. They put CT to work. So I'm gonna take all those boys with me. They can do all the heavy lifting and go home empty-handed.
And they probably would have, well, maybe they, I don't know, after watching this, but I think it would be a disservice if Peacock made you a faithful. So I hope they don't make that mistake. And no one can see, but Taylor put her name and she wrote Taylor Hale, traitor. So she's only here to be a traitor.
Only here to be a traitor. I'm not here to make friends.
Wait, so tell me about, because Johnny Bananas is also randomly, like, I get, I don't know.
Okay. I don't, all right. as someone who has talked a big game about never wanting to be in the challenge space, in the challenge world, like, it's not for me, I don't want beef with the challenge world, all that stuff. Here's my opinion on Johnny Bananas. And I can say this as someone who has met him in real life. The man's ego is larger than the planet Venus. And that's not a bad thing to say. Jupiter, Venus, honestly, the whole fucking Milky Way, like, and whatever other solar or planetary systems are out there, it's all of them combined. I can say some other things, but I'm not a mean person. So, like, Johnny Bananas needs to be the center of attention. And he's used to being the center of attention because he's very good at being the center of attention. Like, there are people who need to be the center of attention that are miserable and you just, like, are begging them to go away. And then there's Bananas who's like, you're being ridiculous, but at least I'm entertained here. So it's relatively harmless at this point in time. Bananas being the first boot, fine, make a couple of jokes, but, like, the shit stirring and the pot stirring and the odd animosity and, like, the weird riling up against Dan online. What are we doing here? Dan is never doing another reality show against you. You don't need a storyline against him. Like, you guys aren't going against on House of Villains. Yeah, there's no rivals, season whatever for you guys. Like, I don't understand what the long-term goal here is. Is it just to rile up the Big Brother community? Which, like,
probably.
Okay. I hope you're getting the clicks. I hope you're getting the clicks, because at least it'd be worth something. That's the only thing I can see out of it. Is this not transparent? Is this not as transparent to everybody else?
And it's also one thing to, like, kind of throw shade at his game, but he went super personal. And Dan's not, like, you know, he's very private with his family. So I didn't love that.
Yeah. Of course not. Of course not. And it's like, I try to be private about other things, too. There are tactics that people on other reality shows, and I'm saying this across the board globally, other reality shows will, like, really try to go for the jugular and try to bait people into things. And it's like, I don't think it's bad for people to not take the bait. So I applaud Dan for not taking the bait. I know there's some really ugly ways that Bananas tried to, like, slither in there a little bit. I don't think it's weak for Dan to not take the bait. I don't think it's him acting like he's above anything or, like, losing the battle because he didn't take the bait. It's just like, okay, you're just not engaging. It is what it is.
And that's his MO. Like, even when people confront him, he sort of just takes a set, you know, he's not to confront. So
honestly, that's how I am. If you come crazy at me, we saw this on TV. I'm like, what? what's up here? Just come with the truth instead of the fire.
Yeah. Talk to me about Kate as a traitor. What were your thoughts on her?
I'm team good TV. I'm team good TV. Here's what I will say. Being a traitor clearly is more difficult than being a faithful. And being Kate as a faithful was hilarious. She was like, get me out of here. I don't want to be here. She had me cracking up. Kate as a traitor, also hilarious. I want traitors that can give funny one-liners. I want traitors that can lean into the campiness of it all. If you take this shit too seriously, it's not fucking fun. I'm here for fun. I've already seen all these people on their respective reality shows. I've already seen them sobbing in a corner, talking about their affairs, ending, like, really intense heavy things, or I don't know, busting open a lip on different competition reality shows, right? I'm here for stupid tartan and camp and maybe a little bit of freaking out over bugs. Again, ill, but it exists, so I have to acknowledge it. Yeah. Kate as a traitor is giving you everything that you want. I want the girl that takes this shit so unseriously, because as an audience, we get to take it unseriously and be stupid and fun. And that is what good reality TV should be, mostly. Obviously, there's going to be depth and everything, but I don't come to Traitors for depth and serious conversations and acknowledgement and representation. I come here for stupid camp with people that I already know.
Yeah, and sometimes it's fun to see someone who might not be the best traitor. Like, we don't want every traitor to be, like, an amazing liar and all that nonsense.
No, like, no. But I will also give her props. Like, I appreciate that. What's her official title? Is it Chief Steward captain?
Chief Stew.
Okay, so I didn't even know. I knew that. Damn, I don't watch Below Deck, y'all. I'd pull that out of my ass. So as Chief Stew on Below Deck, a show that's not about gaming, manipulating, anything like that, the girl came and actually played some solid moves to try to, and actually effectively flipped the vote on to Sandra.
Yeah.
I'm impressed. I would look at Kate as someone who is extremely unserious. So if she comes to me and talks game, I would be like, sure, girl, whatever. I'm gonna do what I'm going to do with the people I already locked in with. You got CT. You got Sandra to question each other. I'm impressed. I will also say, no, I didn't think it was going to work. I thought they were going to look at each other like, yeah, sure, girl, whatever. You're a traitor. I'm out. Furthermore, her decision to murder a fellow Bravo girly. As an outsider, as a viewer, it is so obvious. You murder the person from the clique that you roll with if you were a traitor. But, you know, like, you don't always expect people to do that on the show. She got into that, what do they call that space? The decision layer or whatever? Turret. I would call it the tourniquet. I knew it wasn't a tourniquet. She got into the turret by herself and said, I gotta get rid of one of my own. Bye, Sheree. I kind of wanted to see Sheree stumble her way to the end. But, you know, she got real far, so much further than I expected her to. And I can admire somebody who makes decisions that's in favor of their own game. The one place where she messed up as a solo trader was voting to end the game.
Yeah, what first. Was this?
Were you just cutting yourself off at the knees at that point? Did you just say, screw it, I can make 100 grand on an Instagram deal, I'm a go? Because I can respect that. Ari Lyandyke, even though he got outed, he was like, I'm going to remove myself from this game. So, look, I need the stakes of traders to be higher, says Taylor Hale, who won $800,000 on Big Brother. No, like, I'm sorry. Splitting true. 250? Can we talk about all the reality shows that these people have been on? How much money has Bananas won on the challenge alone? And he was on 50 million reality shows last year alone. CT. Let's talk about
millions at this point.
Thank you. And they've had to do how many reality shows to do that? Let's talk about the Housewives. The Housewives are rich by marriage anyway.
They're
getting and their Instagram deals are looking good.
Their Instagram
per episode.
Deals, per episode, they get paid more than this. So it's Trump change.
And I get it. It's 2 weeks. And hi, again, once again, I'm spoiled, ruined reality star over here talking about money. But like, if you want good people to show up for 2 weeks, when they're usually making off of Instagram that amount of money in a day.
Yep, I know.
What, like, you have to announce a prize that makes the stakes worth it for these people. Like, y'all saw the first episode. They said, and you'll be splitting a prize pot of $250, $50,000. And they were like, oh, yay! Woo! And to look around and be reminded, oh, wait, that's a lot of money. Okay, yay! Come on.
Also,
Peacock,
Taylor,
you got the money.
These missions, it came down to 9 seconds again. And magically, what's going on here?
That's what I'm curious about. I'm very curious. And I only know this because, hi, has done TV 2 times over. So I'm a vet, y'all. No, there are some times where you will have to re-say something and it'll be edited over. What you said on a show, right? This is Notorious and The Bachelor. Frankenbinding is what it's usually called, but Frankenbinding is more so like if they want to create a narrative or a sentence that you didn't actually say. There's also sometimes things where people say, hey, can you say this line again just for safety? So like, I don't know, let's say I'm explaining the rules of a competition. They could say, hey, can you say it A, B, C, D, E, F, G? Okay, can you say it again A, B, C, D, E, G, F, just in case we need to say that instead? So, like, that exists, right? I've been so curious because during these competitions, challenges, whatever the hell we're calling them, you will see Alan in the mix saying, you have 30 seconds left in the middle of the challenge. And then right there next to them will be someone from the show saying, oh, my God, guys, we only have 30 seconds left. So I'm curious. Like, I haven't seen a lot of Frankenbiting around the time. In the later challenges, I will say, I've consistently seen Alan saying we have X amount of time left and then is repeated in the moment by someone on the show saying we have X amount of time left. So I'm curious to see how it goes down. I think you need to get someone on here that'll actually spill the tea on that.
Yeah.
Overall, do I think that the time is truthful? Fuck no. I think it's all lies. I think it's all bullshit. I think it's all planned. It's lies and convoluted tootin' fruit and whatever you want to call it. So maybe they are saying those actual times, but the time just doesn't even matter at all in the end. No.
And you also, know? Like, there were several missions where, like, you could tell Alan was like, oh my God, this is terrible. Like, they sucked at them. So
I'm sorry, but like half of these things couldn't even be Big Brother challenges. They're so complicated. You literally took like the challenge lights. I'll even say you took like an original challenge competition and made it the Traitors, because the challenge used to be like stupid and campy and fun.
Yep.
A little more so, right?
Yep.
So I think there's like the Traitors, oddly enough, is at this happy medium of these very difficult challenges for people who are in their 40s, 50s, 60s. Guys, we have to remember, we're getting reality OGs on these shows.
Yeah.
So they're not spring chickens. They're not like mid-20s and young 30s out here for the first time. They are people who did their last show, competition reality show, 5-6+ years ago. These bitches are old. Or housewives. And the most athleticism we see out of them is like, here's my personal trainer. Like, I'm in my garage, my personal trainer. Or let's go do Soul Cycle together. Or let's lunge over each other on a table. Like, that's the most active we see the housewives getting. And it's fun and entertaining, but it's not swim across on this buoy and figure out this puzzle and all communicate together. Excuse me? Who's coming up with this shit?
You could tell they didn't care. At one point, I think MJ and Kate were like, I'm not doing this. Like,
obviously. You got this. And when you have CT that can do it, yeah. CT, baby, you don't do that. I'd be just like Phaedra. I also have to say this about CT. Yeah. I never saw it for him. I always see people being like, CT's so cute, CT's so hot. And I never could get there. Listen, one of those round tables. I think he had like it's men in knitwear, honestly. I think he had like a nice sweater on or something, and his hair was just curled and coiffed the right way. And I had to pause it, and I said, you know what?
There's something.
There it is. There it is. I see it now. And he looked good at the reunion, too. The hair was nicely coiffed. So CT.
There's like a sweetness about him that I think we saw with Diem back in the day that I think, you know, we didn't always see, but comes out. And it was very sweet to see him with Phaedra, I think.
Yes, I apologize, CT. I was unfamiliar with your game. I was.
Okay, wait. So talk to me about Sandra's game. Because I really thought she had a chance to win. Kate did well, you know, playing that up. But yeah, what do you think? And then Sandra's idea that she had these Traitors angels and that she befriended the Traitors. I know we've all talked about, that's like a good strategy for a faithful.
Obviously.
One, is it the only strategy? And two, I wonder now if people are going to be more aware. Oh, you guys are best friends. Like, why? You know, it's interesting.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What do you think? Well, you know, I think there's a bunch of different ways you can look at it. What's interesting to me is this penchant, and Andy even pointed it out, like these people stick with these people as if I'm not going to be one eventually. but these people stick with the places that they come from. So Bravo sticks with Bravo, CBS sticks with CBS, MTV sticks with MTV, or like gamers versus non-gamers, love shows versus competition shows. It's very interesting how people will align based on the community they're most familiar with. But the Traitors are going to come from all different spaces. So you have to be willing to mingle and let go of the pre-existing relationships or the pensions that you have to align with someone who knows how to play a competitive game. I think that's what made... Man, you know, I just gotta say, Peter, you get on my fucking nerves. Like, the just and truth and loyalty. And again, I'm saying this as the girl that gave a whole speech on girl power rights and really, like, I get it. I really get it. I don't want anybody to think I'm being a hypocrite about this, but Traitors is fun when you're rooting for the Traitors. And when you have people parroting, and I'll talk to Sandra in a second, when you have people just parroting this idea of honor and loyalty and I'm a faithful through and through. That's boring. Faithful till the end of the 2.5 weeks that you're there. Be serious. I'm a faithful till the end. Baby, your show is 14 and a half days. Shut up. So anyway, I just want to shake them. Like, I'm bored with the honor and the justice and the truth of it all. Have fun. Shake that shit off. No one wants to be here for the right reasons. Everyone wants to be here for money, dummy. So, all Peter that to say, the Peter pals. Peter Peterson, fuck right off. So, when you have someone like Sandra, who really made an amazing alliance, broke down the entire game using balls on a pool table. Like, finally, we're seeing someone break up the idea that you have to come from a certain silo to maneuver the game. Finally, we're seeing someone recognize, oh, if I buddy up with the traitors, we can take them to the end and knowingly just knock them all out. Someone is using their brain here, finally. Oh my, a brain in the traitor mansion? Never heard of that before. So yes, I think Sandra played an amazing game. I would like to understand more why it was so easy for Kate, of all people, to manipulate Sandra and CT against each other. I understand, I don't like it, but I understand Trishelle saying, I just want to be on the right side of the vote. I don't like it. I don't like it when I see it on Big Brother. I don't like it when I see it on a bunch of other shows, but I understand the penchant to want to be on the right side of the vote. It's a good way to solidify your partnerships and alliances. If you think that what you suggested is going wrong, like, you don't want to let go of the alliances that you have moving forward. All that being said, Kate was the one to do that. Kate, of all people. Like, Kate's, I think it's, my issue here is that anybody could have made that argument, and Kate did not have the credibility to effectively land this argument. So that's why I'm so shocked that it landed. And I applaud her. I'm proud of her for doing that. That's how you play a game. And it's really cool to see a non-gamer do that, as I said earlier. But when you have a non-gamer doing that against legendary gamers, how does that make sense? You both were already in alignment on voting this person out. So I really feel like there's more. You know she's a traitor. So, and why would you, like, why? The only thing that I can think of right now is that you vote out a faithful that you don't care that much about so that you can take another traitor to the end and get them out. Yeah. That's the only reason I would think that. But there wasn't enough of that emphasized or even hinted towards in the edited show. So it makes these people look stupid. And I know these people aren't stupid. So now here I am on a podcast saying, why do these people look stupid? I think Traitors is doing itself a disservice by not, it's not even like the fourth wall, it's the third and a half wall of just pulling that curtain back and saying, hey, like, this is a strategy people are using to cozy up to Traitors and get to the end together. Like, when you don't include that narrative, the people who are so good at these games look dumb, but really they're smart. And we all know they're smart.
Yep. I think they need to start including that in the edit. And I bet you there is so much shit that they edit out of Sandra and confessionals being like, I know Dan, there's no way Sandra didn't know Parvati was a traitor either. And we really didn't see that. So like, you're right. They need to start including that in the edit. Let's embrace the metagame at this point because we all talk about it. So totally fair. I agree with that. Real quick, back to Peter and his faithfulness. He did get some praise for like his strategy. So were you ever impressed with like him picking up any sort of strategic chops?
I don't know if I can say impressed because I think people severely underestimate The Bachelor as just a love game. I think any of these competition reality shows, The Bachelor is a competition reality show. You have 30 women competing against each other to win something. Love, a ring, the prize of being the next bachelorette, the prize of going on Bachelor in Paradise, whatever it is. Like, this is a competition, right? And there's friendships, love, all things that can come out of it, but at its core, it's competition. And Peter, or any bachelor or bachelorette who is at the helm of all of this, is responsible for maneuvering and navigating 30 other people's manipulative tactics to win.
Oh, did Taylor pause for anybody else or just me? Hold on, chat. Did she pause or did I? Hold on. She paused. Okay, let me remove her, add her back. Let's see. Yeah. Hold on, let me kick her from the studio. Thanks for your patience. She was spitting so much fire, she broke YouTube. Basically, I think. Damn, she was on a roll too. She got cut off. Let me text her. Come back in. Is Does anyone remember the last thing she said? Traitors production cut her off. Peacock silencing Taylor. Oh, okay. All right, let's see. While we're waiting, if you guys have specific questions for Taylor, drop them now and I can start them and make sure to ask them. She must really I'm back. Oh, coming back. Okay, she's coming back. But yeah, if you have questions, drop them now while I'm looking, because the chat's the traitors murdered her. Okay. While we're waiting, if you guys wouldn't mind liking the video, that would be very helpful on YouTube and subscribing. All right, we're back. We are back.
The block is hot, y'all. My phone overheated. I was spinning too much fire. Sorry.
Oh, that's what the chat said. The chat said production is trying to silence you.
They're trying to keep me out, y'all. They're trying
You're
to keep
breaking
me out.
YouTube. Okay.
I hope we're having a good time. So anyway, I was saying, let me close this door real quick. So, as I was saying, The Bachelor is a competition reality series. So when you have someone who is at the helm of this and it's their responsibility to manage the emotions and the feelings of 30 other people, like, Traitors is a cakewalk. I mean, if I was in the position, the stress and the overwhelming responsibility of being a bachelor or bachelorette, I think that's harder than doing Love Island, honestly. Mm. You take me from that environment and plop me in to the Traitors. This is nothing. This is fun. I wish Peter had more fun with it. He took it way too seriously.
Yeah.
But he comes from an environment where everything is life or death. And you are judged by the most moralistic parameters. So yeah. I understand where he comes from. But he doesn't know how to shift gears for what's supposed to be a fun game.
I think you're right. And I think that's where he learned his little door closing. Oh, yes. Sorry, we're having a private conversation here.
Yeah, yeah. And that's so funny because that happens all the time in Big Brother. It's like, oh, can you give us a second? We're having a conversation. But
yeah,
everybody in Big Brother knows what game we're playing. And okay, I just picked up information on who you're talking to now. Mm-hmm. And now you have to explain to me why you had me close the door.
Yeah.
See, well, you just need to know how to navigate this shit.
Yeah, and as we're talking about, like, morality in these games, you know, Janelle brought up at the reunion that, like, the gamers don't take it personally, the non-gamers do. Do you think that's true? Do you think sometimes the gamers take it personally? Like, what are your thoughts
on
that?
Can we please be serious? Janelle, I love you.
Yeah, I love you,
Danny Bear. But can we please, let's talk about these people. There are people from Big Brother who will never speak again because of how they feel they were done so dirty in these games. I'm sure there's people from Survivor, like, for shows that have been on for 20 plus years. And like, let's talk The Challenge too. There are literal multiple seasons of the show for exes and rivals. You see people beefing on the internet all the time. Like, we take this shit seriously. That too, or just like trying to get the fuck away from each other too. Like, we take it personally.
Yeah.
We do. I personally do not. The game, I don't take the game personally. But I think it's a reach. I think it is a reach to say, oh, you know, gamers just have thicker skin, or gamers don't take it personally. I think we know how to better understand what the contract is and what we signed up for. I think we better know how to differentiate. I understand that you're hurt from this game move, but I'm not going to hate you as a person. Yeah. Like, you can be pissed at me. Sure, I get it. Be angry, be mad, or whatever. But that doesn't mean that I'm a bad person or you're a bad person. But we also see many people take that shit so personally that, like, they put hexes and curses on that rival's third grandchild twice removed. So yeah. I think it's just a lot of the first time experiences of game being intertwined with personal, with the people who are non-gamers, quote unquote. So I understand, like, this new exposure to being like, whoa, 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 whoa. I'm so used to my personal life being the thing that's up for discussion and conversation. And now there's a game that's supposed to make that legitimate. Of course I'm going to hate you. Like, okay. Okay. I get where it comes from. I get that you have... Think about these housewives. How long have they been on the show? Oh, minimum 10 years, right? They're used to the most intimate details of their lives being personal and public and up for a conversation in blogs and gossip rags and on, like, overwhelmingly everywhere. But now there is a game that is giving, like, a legitimate mechanic for all of that to fit into. And now people want to say, oh, but it's just a game. It's just a game.
Yeah.
I can understand why it would be a little more personal for some people.
Yeah.
But, you know, learn the environment you're in.
Yeah, and I'm interested to see going forward if people are going to continue this morality thing every season or if people are going to start to learn this is a game. I don't know.
They better learn it's a game. It won't be fun to watch if it's just the morality police. If the Traitors becomes the morality police, it's going to fall off so fast.
Yeah. We need to lean into the campiness more, too. Like, that's the fun of it, I guess. Yeah. I want to talk about, so we haven't seen, you know, our Big Brother people do so well. What do you think that is? Is it the players? Is it something to do with Big Brother and it not translating? Like, what do you think it is? Or they just need the right people?
I think they just need the right people. I got to defend my people. I got to defend my Big Brother people. I think Big Brother has a tendency to get handicapped in other games. Especially when we're put up against people who come from other games, because the beauty, if you want to call it that, a Big Brother is that it is so slow paced, slow paced. And when you have people that play Survivor, look at how well they did on Challenge USA and Challenge MTV and Traitors, right? Like, we see people from Survivor fare very well because they're used to the games being so fast paced. They're used to pivoting and adjusting plans and strategies and only having the opportunity to go with what's right in front of them because that's what time allows. As we saw with Ceri, who won Traitors, who is an icon of Survivor, when she was put in the Big Brother house, it was so much harder for her actual gameplay to last as long as it should have because her pace was at the pace of a show that goes for 2.5 weeks. Maybe she just expected that people were going to see Ceri from Survivor and Traitors winner and be like, get rid of her quickly. So she maybe had the luxury and fun to say, I'm going to move as fast as possible. And the poor thing got trapped there for as long as she did. It's like, I think we need the right people from Big Brother. I want to see more women from Big Brother on there. I want to see Danielle Reyes. And here's also, I would love to do Traitors. I am more than happy to wait 3 more seasons so that we can get some really awesome OGs from our shows. Like, I do want to see Traitors be a show for the people who are mid-30s and up, who got on reality TV in their early 20s 10 plus years ago. I want to see the OGs come back and do something low stakes and fun, and then us little young bucks, we can get in there when we get a little bit older. But there should be some longevity here. So give me a Danielle, I want to see Lisa in there. Put Lisa in there. I want to see June play Traitors. There are so many amazing Big Brother women that I think would fare very well, that I think would be unassuming, that people might lump in more with the Bravo crowd because they're beautiful women and maybe they're more soft-spoken or unassuming. I think it's been really cool to see the people we've had from Big Brother on. Like, of course I'm dying to see Dan play again. I screamed when he was tapped as a traitor. Seeing Janelle in there was amazing. Rachel Riley was so fun to see. Like, Rachel immediately got into a rival with another person who's amazing. Kate on Traitors 2 seasons in a row. Like, these are the people we want to see. Keep that caliber up, but I want to see more Big Brother women in the forefront.
I think
shocker, I'm saying that.
No, I think that's fair. Like, yeah, and I hope, I don't know, maybe Cody and Dan, you know, they're not doing as well. I don't know if that's going to help the Big Brother people next season or make it worse. I don't know. What do you think? It's hard to say.
It is hard to say. It's
this
hard to say.
Gamer thing, I don't know.
Well, that's more what it is. Is it a Big Brother versus Survivor versus the challenge thing, or is it all of the gamers all at once? And I think the only people paying attention to Big Brother is flopping or Survivor is flopping or whatever other competition reality show is flopping. I think the only people that are saying these specific sets are flopping are people who watch competition reality shows.
Yeah.
The people who are fans of Bravo, the people who are fans of Love Island, they're not coming over here and saying, ha ha, your specific TV show is a failure. It's like, no, the gamers are failures. So I think Bravo coming in or Love Island coming in, whatever CBS non-reality show is out there coming in, is going to look at the gamers as a collective and say, them as a whole, either we need to fear or not worry about.
Yeah, I hope it doesn't become like the challenge, like vets versus rookies or something. You know, when it's like every season.
That's so boring. Yeah, I hope but that doesn't again, happen. I think Sandra showed us, like, we have to break out of this come from your own sex. Like, you absolutely have to do that to elevate this game. We're going to come on the third season of The Traitors. I want to see elevated gameplay. I want to see people who know that this shit is a game. If I see another season of people weeping and a moaning and saying, if I were to win Traitors the way that traitor won the TV show on streaming called The Traitors, I would never want to be a traitor like that. They didn't have a choice.
No.
They didn't have a choice. They literally got tapped and said, tag, you're it. Or for Kate specifically, be a traitor or I'll kill you.
Yeah.
You don't have a choice. Yeah. The only time you have a choice is when they try to recruit you.
Yeah.
Then and you Peter, can say no.
Peter should have accepted that, no?
He would have gone to the end if he accepted it.
Or then, went out quickly, either one or the other, but still.
Yeah, because he probably would have been so bad at being a traitor at that point. But it's, again, that's because Peter comes from a position of always being here for the right reasons. Could you imagine a world where Peter is a traitor in the end and he's sitting there next to the Peter pals? End the game? He's going to end the game? He's going to be weeping. He's going to, I just can't do this to you all. We're the pals. And I have to tell you my secret. I'm sorry. I was recruited. I had no choice. And I have to leave the game. You all deserve this. You deserve the money. The money that you're going to go make off a brand deal on Instagram. The money you're going to make off of creating AI merch. Okay.
Oh, my God. AI merch.
But I'm impressed. Okay. He made AI merch.
What do you mean AI? Like,
he's selling merch. He like went to AI and had AI create a design and he's selling merch for it. And I'm not knocking the game. I'm not knocking it. But I'm just saying, like, if you want to talk about the grand prize that was split, 250-ish, he probably already made that in sales off the AI merch that he's selling right now. So like, come on. Of course he's going to leave the game and say, oh, you guys deserve it. Because I can make some money on the back end.
I mean, it's not like Peacock doesn't have the dollars. This show is doing so well. I don't understand.
That's the other thing. I need to know how much these people are getting paid to show up. Because that's probably why the prize is so low.
I mean, yeah, they're getting paid. I know some people get paid six figures. Okay. There's a lot. They're getting paid a lot. I think every season it gets more. So by the time you play Taylor, hopefully that check is pretty hefty.
I used to say I would only go on TV if the check was over what I want a Big Brother. So if they get it up to a milli.
We'll see. I mean.
No, I love Traitors. I would do it without it being a million. I love Traitors.
Well, so someone on Twitter asked, Rod Diaz Twine, with Parv and Sandra coming into the castle with some unresolved history, which BB alum that you've played with would you want to see, I guess, or at least want to see? You don't have to answer that one. But like, anyone in your world that you would want to see maybe play?
I think, like, who's someone that I had beef with on the show that I think would be fun to spar with? That would be, here's how I'm thinking. I want someone that's going to be good TV. Like, I'm always, when it comes to traitors, right, I want someone that's going to be entertaining. So,
I would take it so personal, maybe.
Yeah. I think Jasmine would be really, fun. Really good. And, like, Jasmine and I are cool. I would hang out with her any day. I think Jasmine would be so good on Traitors. That'd be a fun, like, we were kind of on the opposite sides. Maybe we can work together this time. And maybe one of us will be a traitor. Who knows? And then I just think Turner would be hilarious on Traitors, too. And, like, there's not really beef between us. We just, you know, we're on opposite sides for a little bit. Same side, opposite sides, whatever. But he would just be so funny.
No, that's it. Okay. I like that. You can't be on there with, like, a Michael Bruner because people would be like, all right, they're working. Like,
God, I could never be. Well, here's the thing, like, I have my close personal friends, Michael, Brittany, Joseph, but Joseph and I can't do any show together. Like, unless it's a literal amazing race, we can't do any show together without immediately being like, we either go to the end and win the whole thing or we're the first boots, right?
Yeah.
And then Michael, I remember Michael was almost eliminated from Big Brother the first week because people thought he was too quiet and too shady. So, like, it's not going to fare well for him as a traitor.
It's going to be another Dan. Oh, no.
Literally. I love you so much, Michael. You would be another Dan. And I know in the Big Brother world, that's a compliment. Aww. Not here in Traitors universe. And Brittany, I love Brittany. Brittany would drive other people crazy. Because, like, she would just, like, overgame, overthink every single scenario. And so she'd probably have a target on her very, very early on. I can't help her at that point.
Yeah. No, it's tough. Who else did we not talk about from this show? Did you have any opinions about, like, Peppermint, John, Kevin, Tamara? Like, there's a lot of cast we didn't talk about, but, like...
So many.
I don't know, like...
Here's my controversial take on Peppermint.
Okay.
Okay. I've met Peppermint. I love Peppermint. Everyone knows I'm a massive Drag Race fan.
Yeah.
And I really, really, really sympathize with what she's saying, especially at the reunion when she goes, you know, when you enter a place where everyone comes with their own biases, the person who is least like everyone else is going to get picked out first. I don't disagree with what she's saying. I'm not going to sit here and say that there were absolutely no trans, racial, what have you, biases that could have played into her elimination or banishment. Sorry, reality TV is hard. I also, like, I'm not going to sit here and say Trishelle is a terrible person and only targets women of color, even though looking at the track record is maybe not so great looking at the end of the season. Let me reevaluate that. I'm not going to sit here and say all these awful things about Trishelle because she gunned so hard for Peppermint. I think that's just kind of where I fall on it. I don't want to sit here and say Trishelle is a horrible person. I've seen people calling her Trash Shell, and I'm like,
she was getting death threats. I'm like, guys.
It's not that deep. It's not that deep. I think if there's anything, instead of saying, like, Trishelle's a bad person and she's targeting Peppermint because she's trans, it's like, it's not there. Mm-hmm. It could have been. Like, I could easily see a scenario where steps were taken so much further than it needed to be.
Yeah.
I don't think it's as extreme. I think it's, like, maybe a light bias that played into it that could have led.
Yeah.
Right. But I don't think it was this explicit, targeted for trans or racial reasons. The game is literally to go with your gut and suss out any small inkling that you have, right?
Yeah, so like asthma or some dumb shit.
The asthma thing was crazy to me. Tamara at being like, hey, John, can I borrow your inhaler? And he's like, I don't have it. Like, that was crazy to me. All of these things are just the smallest things.
Especially,
and again,
in the beginning. Yeah.
And again, hi, it's me of all people talking and saying this. I got literally everything that you could have thrown out of the book onto me for the littlest, smallest reason. Like, I carried the brunt of it. It is possible to maneuver your way out of these situations. Maybe I should be a little more empathetic because I know it so well. And maybe I'm just hardened because I know it so well, too. It could go either way. But I just don't want to see all of this targeted hate towards Trishelle. Like, there are other reasons why you can be very annoyed with her. Like, this had me cracking up. When she walked up to that group of girls, the Bravo girls, and she was like, so are we ready to talk sense now?
I know. I was like,
girl, shut up. Like, do you want them to work with you or not? Like, what? I can't believe she won. What are you doing? How did she win this game with that attitude? Like, it's, as a viewer, it's funny to me because it's so wacky and ridiculous, and it's just, it's hard to watch other people take it so, so deeply and seriously and, like, intellectualize every little aspect of it. I understand the hesitancy too, but this is supposed to be fun. Yeah. All of that said, instead of sending all that to Trishelle, I would much, much rather have people talk about, hey, let's take what Peppermint says seriously. Let's put our attention on all the anti-trans and anti-LGBTQIA plus laws that are happening. Let's make sure that the crossover between people of color and LGBTQ people is acknowledged. Like, let's uplift this conversation instead of just throwing all this hate on one person, right? Like, that just makes more sense to me. But I don't know. Some people don't want to make sense out there.
Yeah. No, I wonder if they brought it up at the reunion and just didn't show it because, like, obviously her talking about, like, it was like a bigger moment to show that versus like the back and forth. I don't know if there was a back and forth, but that reunion was sort of like, all over the place. I don't know.
Yeah, it was one of those things where I think we just needed like an unedited Bravo style part one, part two reunion released one week after the other. We just needed a little bit more. There's some people that like, what was the guy's name that left?
Deontay.
The boxer. Deontay. Why is Deontay there? You could have recorded like a little weird moment. Does he just, does he live in LA? If he lives in LA, okay, I get it. You guys filmed here in LA. Sure, just show up. But like, he left the episode and someone had to tell me, oh, and so-and-so left. I missed it. Yeah. We needed more fleshed out stories. We needed more moments that actually explained what was happening. And again, I really hope that in the future, Traitors just leans into the idea of the actual game strategy of cozying up to Traitors to win the game, the Traitors. Like this season just felt like that was such a narrative and such a glaring narrative that was removed. And I understand the producers wanting to take that out to protect the integrity of the game, but the integrity of the game has to evolve.
Yep.
Because I'm sorry, but if it doesn't evolve, the season's going to be a fucking failure next season.
Especially
get it together.
If you're casting all these gamers, like they're going to talk about that stuff. They're going to say,
yes.
They also left out, hey, there's four housewives. One of them has to be a traitor. I mean, I guess they did say that. Or like, how many gamers? One of them has to, you know, how many women? How many, all that. Like, let's show more of that, basically.
Yeah. And once again, we are saying this as people who regularly consume competition reality TV shows. I understand. I'm saying this out loud. I'm saying, like, I understand a lot now because I'm learning this in real time as we go. I understand they have to edit this show for people who don't just watch competition reality TV. But at its core, Traitors is a stupid, campy, silly competition reality TV show. So let's focus on that. And not for that much money. Unless, like, you're getting paid to show up, you're not getting paid to win. I will say that from what I have learned today.
Oh my God. Well, all right. We'll start to wrap up. I feel like we did hit a lot of points, but like, was there any other big takeaways from the reunion, from the finale itself? I'm trying to think who did we not talk about? I mean,
I just think the finale was fun. And I think finale should be fun. Like I was doing my makeup, getting ready to go to a birthday dinner. And I was like, let me watch this real quick before I have to get out and the night gets away from me or whatever. And I literally I almost burned my hair off. I was trying to straighten it and I'm watching Trishelle change her mind and CT changes his mind. And MJ's like, and let's end the game. And all this flip-flopping's happening. I'm screaming. I'm burning my hair. My dog is barking because I'm losing my mind because it's so fun.
This is
what TV should be. So I just want to applaud it felt like a fun game to watch. The stakes were high enough in the end. The money was not, but the stakes were. Like, this was enjoyable. This is what TV should be. And the bickering back and forth between Bravo fans and competition reality fans, like, I'm enjoying it because I think that's what TV does. It just lets people argue amongst themselves. And you know, I think our job as reality stars, competition reality players, whatever the hell you want to call us, influencers, whatever, it's to give fans who enjoy these shows something fun to engage with. And if they want to engage in a way that's not fun, that's not our responsibility. But it's our job to create a product that is fun to engage with. And I think that they did a really great job this season, the people who were on the show and the producers. It's only up from here.
Yeah, I agree. Do you think the fans go too hard sometimes? Like, take it too seriously? Yeah. Or?
Yeah, of course. We just said Trishelle was getting death threats.
Yeah. I don't want to offend and just say, oh, it's all the Bravo people. Because, listen, I'm a Bravo person, too.
Yeah. So
it's not just that. But I want people to embrace the silliness more.
Honestly, if any of these shows are the most silly of anything, the Bravo shows are the silliest ones, right? Like, we see the most antics and comedy and silliness from these shows. Competition reality is usually the thing that takes itself too seriously. Like, let's talk about it. Big Brother people are out here talking about it's life or death, and then 5 seconds later, you'll be in a fucking banana costume. Getting, like, fake monkey poop is being thrown on your head and you're like, I need to win this to secure my safety because this person betrayed me. It's life or death. Baby girl, you've got monkey dung being thrown on your face in a banana costume. So it's perspective. Our perspective. Perspective matters here, but the fans are going to be fans. Stands are going to be stands, but it's just my job as a personality, like, give y'all something good to engage with. That's all.
Love it. And Taylor, what happens when they don't make you a traitor? How upset will you be?
Oh my God. I'll be Kate. I'll be like, just get me out of here. What am I doing this for? Because no, that's when you're really, oh, now I'm heated. That's when you're really going to hear me talking about, and this prize pot is at $30,000 right now. And y'all want me to climb up this mountain to share the money in the end? Send me home. And then hopefully someone will make me a traitor. But I will be begging them to get rid of me at that point. Because here's what I'm going to tell you right now. My guarantee, I will negotiate a nice guarantee so that if I get sent home on day two, I won't have to worry about food. I will tell you that. So if I'm not a traitor come day three, get me out. I'm done because I'm not splitting no damn money. I'm not doing it. Not here.
Oh my God. All right. Well, yeah. I know we're going to see you on the show. I don't know how soon, but I'm excited about it either way.
I cannot wait. My CBS contract is done in September. So until September, you will see me as a loyal CBS girly, and unless they decide to give me further employment elsewhere, free agent.
All right. Yeah. So anyone asking why Taylor hasn't been on, obviously, because she's under contract still.
Yeah. So. And it didn't overlap with Reindeer Games. Actually, my Reindeer Games contract expires like today, I think.
It's not as long. That's good.
No, not at all.
All right. Well, I appreciate you, Taylor. Everyone, please like and subscribe as usual. I hope I'm going to talk to some people early next week. We'll see. A lot of revisionist history in some of these interviews. I don't know.
Well, you talked to Sheree, who knew who the traitors were the whole time?
Yeah, that was interesting.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't know about that. All right. Well, thank you all for joining. And thank you again, Taylor. This was so fun. I love catching up with you.
Thanks, Sharon. You're the best.